Hide and Seek by Wilkie Collins. Read by Nicholas Boulton for Naxos Audiobooks. Opening Chapter. A Child's Sunday. At 1:15 on a wet Sunday afternoon in November 1837, Samuel Snoxell, page to Mr. Zachary Thorpe of Beargrove Square, London, left the area gate with 3 umbrellas under his arm to meet his master and mistress at the church door on the conclusion of morning service. Snoxell had been specially directed by the housemaid to distribute his 3 umbrellas in the following manner. The new silk umbrella was to be given to Mr. and Mrs. Thorpe. The old silk umbrella was to be handed to Mr. Goodworth, Mrs. Thorpe's father, and the heavy gingham was to be kept by Snoxell himself for the special protection of Master Zack, aged 6 years, and the only child of Mr. Thorpe. Furnished with these instructions, the page set forth on his way to the church. The morning had been fine for November, but before midday the clouds had gathered, the rain had begun, and the inveterate fog of the season had closed dingily over the wet streets far and near. The garden in the middle of Beargrove Square, with its close-cut turf, its vacant beds, its brand-new rustic seats, its withered young trees that had not yet grown as high as the railings around them, seemed to be absolutely rotting away in yellow mist and softly steady rain, and was deserted even by the cats. All blinds were drawn down for the most part over all windows. What light came from the sky came like light seen through dusty glass. The grim brown hue of the brick houses looked more dirtily mournful than ever. The smoke from the chimney pots was lost mysteriously in deepening superincumbent fog. The muddy gutters gurgled. The heavy raindrops dripped into empty areas audibly. No object, great or small, no out-of-door litter whatever, appeared anywhere to break the dismal uniformity of line and substance in the perspective of the square. No living being moved over the watery pavement, save the solitary Snoxell. He plodded on into a crescent, and still the awful Sunday solitude spread grimly humid all around him. He next entered a street with some closed shops in it, and here at last some consoling signs of human life attracted his attention. He now saw the crossing sweeper of the district, off duty till church came out, smoking a pipe under the covered way that led to a mews. He detected through half-closed shutters a chemist's apprentice yawning over a large book. He passed a navigator, an ostler, and 2 costermongers wandering wearily backwards and forwards before a closed public house door. He heard the heavy clop-clop of thickly booted feet advancing behind him, and a stern voice growling,
"Now then, be off with you, or you'll get locked up."
And looking round, saw an orange girl, guilty of having obstructed an empty pavement by sitting on the curbstone, driven along before a policeman, who was followed admiringly by a ragged boy gnawing a piece of orange peel. Having delayed a moment to watch this Sunday procession of 3 with melancholy curiosity as it moved by him, Snoxell was about to turn the corner of a street which led directly to the church, when a shrill series of cries in a child's voice struck on his ear and stopped his progress immediately. The page stood stock still in astonishment for an instant, then pulled the new silk umbrella from under his arm and turned the corner in a violent hurry. His suspicions had not deceived him. There was Mr. Thorpe himself, walking sternly homeward through the rain, before church was over. He led by the hand Master Zack, who was trotting along under protest, with his hat half off his head, hanging as far back from his father's side as he possibly could, and howling all the time at the utmost pitch of a very powerful pair of lungs. Mr. Thorpe stopped as he passed the page, and snatched the umbrella out of Snoxell's hand with unaccustomed impetuosity, said sharply, "Go to your mistress, go on to the church," and then resumed his road home, dragging his son after him faster than ever.
"Snoxy! Snoxy!"
screamed Master Zack, turning round towards the page so that he tripped himself up and fell against his father's legs at every third step.
"I've been a naughty boy at church!"
"Oh, you look like it, you do," muttered Snoxhill to himself sarcastically as he went on.
With that expression of opinion, the page approached the church portico and waited sulkily among his fellow servants and their umbrellas for the congregation to come out. When Mr. Goodworth and Mrs. Thorpe left the church, the old gentleman, regardless of appearances, seized eagerly on the despised gingham umbrella, because it was the largest he could get, and took his daughter home under it in triumph. Mrs. Thorpe was very silent, and sighed dolefully once or twice when her father's attention wandered from her to the people passing along the street.
"You're fretting about Zack," said the old gentleman, looking round suddenly at his daughter. "Never mind. Leave it to me. I'll undertake to beg him off this time."
"It's very disheartening and shocking to find him behaving so," said Mrs. Thorpe, "after the careful way we've brought him up in, too."
"Nonsense, my love. No, I don't mean that. I beg your pardon. But who can be surprised that a child of 6 years old should be tired of a sermon 40 minutes long by my watch? I was tired of it myself, I know, though I wasn't candid enough to show it as the boy did. There, there, we won't begin to argue. I'll beg Zack off this time, and we'll say no more about it."
Mr. Goodworth's announcement of his benevolent intentions towards Zack seemed to have very little effect on Mrs. Thorpe, but she said nothing on that subject, or any other, during the rest of the dreary walk home through rain, fog, and mud, to Beargrove Square. Rooms have their mysterious peculiarities of physiognomy as well as men. There are plenty of rooms, all of much the same size, all furnished in much the same manner, which, nevertheless, differ completely in expression, if such a term may be allowed, one from the other, reflecting the various characters of their inhabitants by such fine varieties of effect in the furniture features generally common to all, as are often, like the infinitesimal varieties of eyes, noses, and mouths, too intricately minute to be traceable. Now, the parlour of Mr. Thorpe's house was neat, clean, comfortably, and sensibly furnished. It was of the average size. It had the usual sideboard, dining table, looking glass, scroll fender, marble chimney piece with a clock on it, carpet with a drugget over it, and wire window blinds to keep people from looking in, characteristic of all respectable London parlours of the middle class. And yet it was an inveterately severe-looking room, a room that seemed as if it had never been.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.